Berks Business. I'm Bob Wert, Managing Director of Investments for the Wert Investment Consulting Group of Wells Fargo Advisors. Each month on Berks Business, we give you the opportunity to meet the leaders of our regional business community. And tonight, we get to meet a leading educator from that business community and also some of his best students teaching us about the stock market game and also the Invest Right contest. So our guest tonight is Mr. Tim Hetrick of Wyomissing High School.
Hetrick? Thank you, Bob. And once again, it's wonderful to be here. My name is Tim Hetrick. I'm a teacher of economics and American history at Wyomissing Area High School. This is about the 25th year that I've been involved in the Pennsylvania stock market game as well as the national game. And I brought in four of my students for my honors class, and I think I'll allow them to introduce themselves. Alex?
I'm Alex Fry, a senior at Wyomissing.
I'm Nate Tebow, a senior at Wyomissing as well.
I'm Chelsea Webb, and I'm also a senior at Wyomissing.
And fourth, Allison Shinsky, also a senior.
Well, tell us a little bit about the stock market game and what you were trying to teach. What were your teaching objectives with the class?
Okay, great. The stock market game is something that's been running for over 30 years now. I've been involved in it for about 25 years throughout my years of teaching economics. It affords me an opportunity to bring some real-life creativity to my classroom. We talk about the market, we talk about various aspects of investment, but the stock market game is fun, it's unique because it's a simulation. It allows students to do investing with real-time information on real-time data points in the various stock and bond markets, mutual funds. The only thing that isn't real would be the $100,000 that they're gifted in each of their portfolios. But it's a 10-week experience that allows them to put in practice what we've been talking about in the classroom. And it's just a great educational extension of my classroom.
How does the game differ from real life? In a 10-week simulation, how would you make decisions differently from you would do it if you were actually investing somebody's money?
That's a great question, Bob. And that's one I think I might turn over to my students, because we've talked about that enough. Our 10-week time horizon might be a lot different from what they might face in the real world. So that might be a good jumping off point for our students to get involved, just talking about this in broad strokes as an activity.
Great. Go ahead.
Allison, would you like to jump in?
Well, for the stock market game, we're supposed to take a very short-term approach to things. We're supposed to focus on more one stock in particular, two or three, and try not to diversify very much because we're hoping for a very high investment yield. Mm-hmm. But in real life, you really shouldn't try that.
Exactly.
Yeah, there's not a lot of downside, obviously. You're playing with money that really is not your own. So there's, as Allison was saying, it's more speculative. There's no downside. But the upside to that is really neat application of research opportunities, learning about markets by not only how the company is run, but also the overall nature of the business cycle and the economy and how that affects the micro world.
So Chelsea, what tools did you use to decide which stocks to buy?
I actually did a lot of research. Like, most of my time was actually spent looking at the different stocks and what their like highs and lows were and if it would be wise to buy it at that point.
So were you looking at companies that were near their high or near their low?
I was looking at things that were near their low but had the potential to go back up.
Okay. Nate, same kind of questions. How did you pick what you picked?
Well, to be honest, at first, my group, Carly and Ashley and I, really didn't know what we were doing. And so a lot of the first stocks were big name ones like Home Depot and other sort of companies that you really
you
hear about in the media.
Company and things like that.
And also we picked stocks that were on the way up, which was, in hindsight, a mistake because the law of averages is going to dictate that things are going to kind of spiral back down to peaking. So after a couple of weeks into the game, I was starting to look more at companies that were taking drops based off of buyer speculation and not really the integrity of the company itself.
So what you just described, Chelsea just described being a value investor, looking for bargains, looking for things that are cheap, solid companies that have the opportunity to turn around. And Nate, you just described initially being a growth investor, looking for companies that were at their high, prospering, and looking to go even further. But then, because of the market environment you were in, you changed your tune and changed strategies.
Yeah.
So, with actual real-life money managers get fired for that very thing. Because if you sign up to be a value investor and your clients come with you on the premise that you're a value investor, if you change over to being a growth, or if you're a growth investor, you change to being value, it confuses the clients. But you know, it's different when you're in a simulation, but it's interesting.
And experience to learn.
Yeah, exactly right.
If I could jump in there, Bob, that's part of the beauty of this educational experience. It gives our students an opportunity to shift those gears, mm-hmm. to look at different avenues, to look at different strategies. I liken it to riding a bike. It's really neat to see kids making decisions with very little understanding, but gradually over a period of weeks, months, developing more of a sophistication and more of a business model for where do I put this money and how do I invest and what is the strategy, the underlying ways that I want to place this money.
Chelsea was echoing Bernard Baruch and Sir John Templeton. And it's the exact same philosophy from some of those famous investors of all time. Alex, how about you?
Well, we took a little bit more of a volatile approach. My group and I, we decided that it would be more effective to do real-time research. So we did research by the day, and on days like, I remember over Valentine's Day, we put a lot of money into companies that would, you know, have a big profit over this certain time. And we also did some research into a big computer company, and they had, you know, pretty big products that were coming out, and so we made a lot of money, you know, buying low and selling it when it came to its peak. So
you're almost doing like a computer-driven type of a trade?
Yeah, and I did lots of work on my phone, you know, checking stocks and how they were doing in the morning, and then also looking at the newspaper and seeing how they're doing.
How often can you trade during the day? Or is it just once per day, or is it?
Well, we were allowed to trade when we got home from school, and we also were able to in the morning in class.
Unlimited. They, as long as they had the funds to back it up.
Oh, so is that new this year or recently?
No, that's been, I tell the kids, hey, these are the tools. This is the website. It's like being online and brokering in for yourself throughout the day, throughout the night. Go ahead, Nate. I know you wanted to add on to that.
But the stocks, when you sold them, they would lock in at their closing price for that day. So you weren't able to day trade, per se, but you could sell and buy throughout the day.
And you could only use U.S. stocks?
No. If any foreign stocks sold on New York or American Exchange, you could purchase anything that you want.
Because one of the things that traders had done was find companies that closed overseas and buy their U.S. equivalents.
Yeah.
And I imagine if you wanted to play the game, it doesn't work in real life, but it's kind of, it might be interesting for the game.
It could be.
Don't know if that would work or not. So what did you learn? Alex, I'll start with you.
Well, I learned a lot about how to use different tools to invest in stocks and how they played out in the real world. You know, like I would look at the New York Times and my dad had it all the time, and I would always see the different, you know, different things about stocks, and I never really understood how they were. But now, given our, you know, the big part that it plays in the game, mm-hmm. I was able to sit down and look at the paper and read how all my different stocks were doing every day, and you know how they would fluctuate, you know, over time, whether it be their PE ratio or all those different types of things.
And so you had a real world connection to things that are in the newspaper.
Most definitely. Like it made stock market trading a very tangible thing, you know, much more than it was before we played the game.
Makes sense. Nate?
I really learned the importance of research and understanding what you're looking for and what your goals are and where a company is going to be heading in the future before you buy anything.
So actually taking the time to know what you own?
Yes.
Yeah. Now, if you were in the confines of a 10-week game, how would you apply those lessons to a longer time frame?
Well, I would first do research before I bought anything, but then I would continue to keep up on what that company is doing. Obviously, you can't do the research we were doing almost every day in later in life with your schedule, but it'd be something to look into, like, at least once a week and track your company and look for times to sell and times to buy.
So you'd find yourself being a frequent trader?
I could see myself doing that.
If I could jump in on that,
sure.
Bob. I just wanted to make sure that I was very clear. My goal in this whole process is to develop financial literacy for my students to understand the various markets, what drive those markets, the companies that are out there. I don't know that I'm trying to make them into financial analysts,
right. Okay.
Especially at the tender age of 17. But I certainly want them to have the financial literacy and the understanding that there are some mechanisms out there besides just a savings or checking account, mm-hmm. which might provide them better growth potential. This is an adult thing. It's kind of like driving a car. It can get you from point A to point B very easily, financial independence or helping to grow your assets for future goals that you might have. It can also be a very risky thing. And so, again, I say it's financial literacy. It's understanding of the real world adult decisions, not necessarily making financial analysts out of my students.
But yeah, it's also kind of like driving a car, which might be a relatively new experience.
Yeah.
But done well, it's an extraordinarily useful tool.
A powerful tool.
Very powerful tool, but it can also kill you. And you know, with markets too, they're very powerful tools that can change your life in a very good way, but you have to use, like any tool, you have to use it properly.
I would add, if there are any teachers who are out there or any parents from other districts, this is a great tool for teaching financial literacy. And there's just so much there in a fun sense. I think my students actually enjoyed coming to economics, hopefully not just for the simulation experience. Hopefully it goes beyond that in our relationship with the classroom. But I think it added a real-world dynamic that I couldn't replicate in any other way. And maybe it's a shameless plug. I wanted to say thank you for sponsoring our students each year in that Pennsylvania Stock Market Game.
Quite welcome. Happy to help. It's good to see the fruits of, you know, it's nice when you see actual people who are being benefited by something, who learn something, and it makes a meaningful difference. Chelsea, let's talk about financial literacy. That's the goal of the class. So did you learn more than just, you know, the savings account and that sort of thing? How did that help you progress in your knowledge?
Well, I had already known, like, about the savings account thing, but I was totally clueless about stocks. Like, I knew what the stock market was, but I didn't know how it worked or, like, how to use it in, like, everyday life. And now I actually feel like I could go on and invest in stocks.
So from actually having done it in a hypothetical way, you feel more comfortable in a real way?
Yes, I do.
Okay. So I gather you have a relationship that has a certain amount of fun involved in it by the quiet and shy, reserved nature that you've exhibited. Let's talk a little bit about how it is that it's fun to go to class, or what makes it more interesting.
Allison didn't have that much fun, obviously.
I see that. Okay.
But I know every Monday they logged on and there was some excitement.
It was pretty cool at first. I mean, well, I shouldn't say at first. When we first started it, we were like, oh my God, what is this thing? Because we started out on Google Finance, and the group of girls I was in were completely clueless, and we were just kind of fumbling around. We didn't know what any of the numbers meant or what any of the charts or readouts were saying. And thankfully, Mr. Hetrick started it and began to show us what everything meant. And then we went around teaching each other, and we finally started out with the same stocks.
So, okay, I'd like to take a moment here for a break for our friends at Berks Community Television.
On bctv.org. Be informed, be involved, be a member. For membership information, go to www.bctv.org/support/membership. To read other stories concerning local businesses, go to www.bctv.org.
Yeah, for the second half of our program tonight, we're going to be talking a little bit about the InvestRight contest, which was kind of a different approach. The idea being, if someone close to you inherited $50,000, how would you advise them to invest? So it's actually kind of a very practical, real-world type of experience, something that I do every day, different scale, but same idea. Yeah. And it's interesting to hear some of the answers we got. So Tim, why don't you tee this up a little more?
Okay, I'll make a quick introduction for the National InvestRight Essay Contest. I've sent emails as a coordinator for our school, in the stock market game each year. Would you be interested in extending that experience to a national essay writing contest? In the last couple of years, I've had some great students, but I was waiting for the right class, the right chemistry, with some excellent writers, and this was the year I really wanted to take that opportunity, present it to my students, and as you had said, Bob, briefly, the said was, a person inherits $50,000, but I think I don't want to steal any of that limelight from my students. They may want to tell you what the set was and what they had to do in order to write that essay that I could submit to a national contest.
Did every student do an essay? Was it individual or was it by teams? How did it work?
Well, I kind of forced that issue. I said, you're the class I want, but I'm willing to back it up. I made it a pretty heavily weighted fourth quarter grade for seniors who don't have the full 8 weeks because they graduated early. The points actually, I twisted their arm a bit to participate.
Good. So, all right, well, let's hear about these essays.
Okay. They were interesting. We started out with just basic framework, and Mr. Hatchard really helped us from whatever our launch point was. Mine was pharmaceutical companies, and try to go as far as we could with it.
Okay.
We had a basic horizon where the person we were supposed to be advising was going to be retiring in 15, 20 years. They were about our parents' age, and we were supposed to be helping them. So you had to work out, oh, well, will this give dividends? Will this try to help them yearly, or will they have to like keep paying into it? Do we want to diversify or not, or how much risk you're willing to take? It was really interesting.
And how did you come up with pharmaceuticals?
Mostly just because the baby boomer generation is getting old. Mm-hmm. They're getting older and are going to need more help. So that was just kind of...
So the theme was demographics, mm-hmm. to say that this is a growing market, we want to participate in it, and it's already something that pays dividends. So why did you just stick to one industry as opposed to diversifying across many?
Well, I did half of it in pharmaceuticals and the other half in just a basic mutual fund that would pay dividends.
Okay.
Because the theoretical person I was supposed to be helping could use the yearly help.
Right.
So.
Makes sense. Chelsea?
Well, I had invested in real estate since things are getting better in the economy and like now is the time to be buying houses, and that will only go up further. And I chose stocks that would pay dividends because most people will want that income since they aren't working anymore.
So you looked at real estate investment trusts?
Yes.
And so you were attracted to the dividend yield, like the 3-5% kind of a dividend
yes.
yield? And
which is a good yield
sure.
at this point. That's a great...
Not a guarantee, but it's a good point.
Mm-hmm.
And did you just get one, or did you get a whole portfolio of those?
I actually chose two different ones because I didn't just want to put money into one
right.
and have that fail and not have anything else to back up on.
So did they have the opportunity to invest in, say, something broad like exchange-traded funds or something that would have a lot of diversification, or did they have to pick individual stocks?
They did not have to pick individual stocks. The parameters of the game said they had to pick at least two different investment vehicles, such as two stock companies, or example, bonds or securities in the stock. That was kind of the direction we took as we looked at the instructions. I put that on my PowerPoint, and we all looked at, you know, what do they mean? Because we wanted, this is my first year okay. running through the essay.
So Nate, tell us about what you wrote, what you did.
Well, I invented a Greek guy who is the manager of a Mediterranean restaurant, who the president of which is a very generous man and volunteered to match his 401k and also mm-hmm. is allowing him to retire at 50. So he was sitting on some money as well as going to get that money increased by his employer. So
you were allowed to fully embellish?
Yeah.
Okay.
I decided I was going to have some fun with it.
Yeah, I was going to jump in there. The kids could create their own person, and Nate was a beautiful example in the Greek tradition where we're going to retire early. I got a good chuckle, and I thought, that's a good hook. I said, good writers find that good hook. They find that interest level, and they play to the interest as well as giving hopefully some sophisticated evidence for their investment and proof for its
So the idea, purpose. Because you're writing an essay contest, to make it interesting for the judge?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Okay. Yes. So then you came up with, tell us more again about what you did.
Well, I looked to the housing industry and sort of lumber and building companies as in a rebounding housing market, they have a lot of potential to grow.
So you're picking up on Chelsea's value style?
Yes.
Okay. So the thought was, here's an industry that's down but not out, and you want to get into it early and ride with it. Okay. Alex?
Well, like Nate, I had quite a bit of fun with this this assignment. My character was a dog breeder who had a bit of money, but you know, $50,000 never hurt. So I decided to put most of the money into a car rental company because I figured it's more of a sound investment because over time, obviously, you know, everybody's gonna need to rent cars, and it seemed like a wise investment at the time because it can make money and over time have a good yield.
So. Imagine now you were the client, and your financial advisor just came to you and said, you had $50,000, I want you to put it all in a car rental company.
It was a little bit more of a risky investment, but given the amount of research that I did, it sounded like it was more sound than one would perceive to think it is.
Okay. It's interesting. I mean, you're coming at it from the position of an actual financial advisor in terms of you're actually sitting in front of somebody who has this money, and you have to make some recommendations for that person.
Yes.
It's always interesting, I think, as a good mental exercise to pretend to be that other person. Mm-hmm. And what would it be like to be sitting in the client's chair hearing that? And how would you feel if somebody said, well, let's put all your nest egg in X, whether it be a car rental company or housing or pharmaceuticals, you name it. So I think from an essayist standpoint, I like the idea that you took the creativity and made it up and ran with it, just kind of make it fun. What else did you do to make your essays interesting or to do well in the class or the contest?
I led it up to the individual students to create their own individuals, but stay within the parameters of the $50,000 inheritance, as well as trying to get some diversification into their portfolio. I think it was an interesting perspective, however, because they had already finished the stock market game, and they had already, on that bicycle that I thought about, ridden and sometimes crashed,
right.
As far as portfolio valuation. It gave them an opportunity to start over again and to share their wealth of understanding and knowledge in a written sense with some other fictitious person. And that's what I liked about the stock market, about the essay. It also worked on a lot of really creative, yet persuasive writing skills.
And so it's kind of a twofer in that regard.
Oh yeah, it just had so many great educational dynamics to it that this is the year I finally couldn't resist it. We're gonna do this and we're gonna do it well.
Well, you can have the best ideas in the world, but if you can't get anybody to act on those ideas, they're pointless.
True.
So if you if you're able to articulate a case, regardless of whether it's investing or political or any other kind of issue, you have to be able to make that.
It did force the students to go back and say, okay, let's start again. What did I learn from my 10-week experience? And let me rewrite that, rethink that, reevaluate all of my decisions, and maybe use some different strategies and different options.
So what time horizon did they have from the conclusion of the stock market game to the conclusion of the InvestRight contest?
The conclusion of the stock market game and the beginning of the investment portfolio, I think it was about 2 weeks, or the investment essay, I should say. It was about 2 weeks when we started to write. Do you guys remember that exactly? It was a very short period of time when I said, when I brought out that essay contest. We haven't heard the final culmination. That evaluation is probably being done right now. I'm anxious to hear this week if we have any of the
So you will get it before graduation?
Oh, absolutely.
Okay.
Yes.
Yeah, and this is a major part of the grade. So you graded it for the purpose of your class, but then it was also the national contest.
A national committee is now evaluating with financial investors like yourself who are reading it for strategies, understanding of the market, how that was conveyed.
In the minute or so we have remaining, I just want to ask each student briefly, what was the one most important thing that you learned from this experience? And Alex, I'll start with you.
Oh, it's most definitely, be wise with your money. and do lots of research. Lots of research is what pays off in the end, having sound investments and also something that your client is very happy with as well, something that they think that they can sit on for a while. So.
Makes good sense, Nate.
Really just the importance of information, like gathering it from multiple sources, not trusting just based off of a hunch, trusting based off of hard evidence and information.
Okay, Chelsea?
Diversifying, like not putting your money into only one thing, putting into multiple things so that if one goes down, you still have the others.
Okay. Elsa?
Understanding where the person you're whose money you're investing is coming from, knowing their position and what you can do to make their lives better.
Sounds like you've taught them well.
Hope so.
Well,
time will tell.
Right. Our guest has been from Wyomissing High School, the seniors there, and their teacher, Mr. Tim Hetrick. I'd like to thank our audience for joining us on Berks Business. I'm Bob Wert, Managing Director for Investments of the Wert Investment Consulting Group, Wells Fargo Advisors. I'd like to thank you for joining us on Berks Business, and we'll see you again second Monday of next month. Good night.